little pig pack goes in the danger zone. There's a rumbling ground down below. There's a big dark town. It's a place I've found. There's a world going on underground.
That evening, Al took me to a dance. Never had I known that there could be such pleasure. And as a part of it all, I discovered that my education was to continue through every waking hour. Whether in scheduled class or not, there was so much to be learned from actual living. And Arl, it seemed, was determined that nothing should be lacking in my education, nor did I object, for nothing suited me better than to have her beautiful tail and all showing her friendship and interest. The dance, she told me, on the way to the hall in a roulette car, was very scientifically handled by trained technicons. The stimulation of human attraction between male and female, she told me, was due to the generation of many kinds of tiny and fecund spores, which grow and are released upon stimulus by male and female. The male spores grow in the female, and vice versa, just as pollen between flowers. This cell pollen and the sensation of its growing presence is love. I could imagine the immense fecundity given this process by the strength of the Atlan race, whose growth and youth. The Atlans, Mr. Shaver reveals, were ever youthful and never ceased growing. There was no such thing as maturity in the sense that growth stopped. Thus, an Atlan's age could be determined, to a certain extent, by his size. Many of them reached tremendous stature, sometimes as much as 300 feet, and heights of 40 feet and more were rather common. Mr. Shaver refers to ancient books, which have been destroyed, which contained a great deal of Atlan knowledge and history, but points to references in the Bible, such as, "In those days there were giants in the earth," as actual truth, recorded memory of the Titans. Especially significant is the definite statement, "in the earth," not "on it." The Atlans, by the use of their wonderful machines, kept their bodies constantly supplied with a sufficient amount of ext, the energy ash from which all matter is formed by condensation, so that their growth never stopped. But their bodies grew ever larger and heavier. Health itself was determined by weight. A healthy person was heavy. If he became ill, he lost weight. Illness is the inability of the body to fully utilize the available ext, or is the result of an insufficient quantity of ext. Editor. Never cease. We arrived at the place where the dance was to be held, and I found a great room tastefully draped and decorated by paintings that depicted such scenes of love and joy and health as I have never before seen. Just as the paintings of the Hall of Symbols held forth that invitation to join in the elevation of the race, so did these paintings show the way to participation in love and joy. The dance had already begun, and we joined the throng on the floor. Almost instantly, I was aware of the influence of stimulating electromagnetic frequencies. I felt the flow of ext, of appropriate attunements. My nerve cells responded in a thrilling fashion. The stimulating rays strongly ionized the air of the hall, making it extremely conductive to the electric pressure of the body aura, so that the dancers were intensely aware of each other. The consequently augmented vital aura of the cell pollen permeated the hall. It was absorbed by my body, and by that of lovely fawn-legged Arl snuggled in my arms, and by all the young ecstatic bodies of those who danced about us. Under the stimulus, we wove intricate patterns on the gleaming floor, and the odor music of the Atlans wove into the sound music many scent accompaniments. These scents are of the most penetrative and nutrient of all the food chemicals, feeding the nerves as they are driven into the body by strong sound waves of a penetrative frequency. In the enhanced delight of the dance, I was oblivious of all but the bundle of vitality to which my pulse and soul were synchronized, and my arms held Arl as a treasure beyond value. Then, as I lost myself in pleasure, it happened. The madness of the fear that was upon Tean City struck, and for the first time in my life, I knew the true meaning of terror. Arl screamed, and pushing me from her, pointed to the edge of the dance floor. There, the great shoulders of a horned son of a titan hunched, one big hand clutching in desperate agony at the folds of a drape, the other pointing up and out to indicate the path of the ray that played upon him. Even in the face of death, his only thought was to tell what he knew of the fear, and to point out its direction, so that the Technicons might answer with a ray of their own, but nothing checked the ray. And I realized that contrary to all the usual rules, there was no guard ray on duty. No wonder there was fear in Atlan. Slowly, the huge youth's face turned black. His legs buckled, he fell and rolled over on his back, tongue protruding and eyes staring. He was dead. His friends rushed to him, but the deadly ray had not ceased. It played first on one victim and then on another, each victim rolling in turn on the floor, face black with death. By the Elder Gods! I swore to myself at the realization that no guard ray was going to protect us. It is true, our perfect government is not so perfect after all. I stood as though oblivious to the fact that death might strike my way too. I could only look and rage within me at the death that played about the recently joy-filled hall. Within me, the stimulating rays still caused an elation, but it was submerged beneath the surge of wrath that made my blood hot. Arl was tugging at my elbow, the canny will to live of the female evident on her face in an expression of anxiety and calculation. Together we left the hall, taking a route along which her clicking hooves led me. We kept with a group of young Atlans who walked without panic or the impulse to run. Toward the parked Rolats. I knew why. They feared to attract the spy ray to themselves. Arl's fingers pressed warningly on my arm, and I heard her whisper, her voice low, casual. An excited tone might have attracted the curiosity of the mad mind behind the Black Deaths, who must even now be surveying the scene of his mad acts of killing in grisly satisfaction.
Listen to that man just behind us.
I listened. His voice was also casual. Held no excited note. In his voice was the cultured note that was evidence of one who has absorbed much of the vast education obtainable in Tean City. Also heard that what lies behind the fear and death here is the mad wish of certain Rodites to appropriate the whole fleet of ships prepared for the migration and go to the new sun, leaving nothing behind alive with brains enough to build and fly ships in pursuit. Thus, they would have the new sun's clean light entirely for themselves and their future seed. A selfish thing indeed, but more mad than selfish. Such a view could only be the result of detrimental air. The speaker went on.
We, the mediocre, know how fecund life can be, but we also know the madness of refusing all of the normal units of life's fabric the right to existence and growth. No social fabric can be built of dull and lifeless robots, which are so besotted with detrimental energy that they refuse the least of the units of the fabric their right to growth and intelligence. Therein lies the strength of the social fabric, the unit's realization of its own self and its place in the whole. The whole basis of a fuller life is the acquisition by mutual effort, the backing on which is woven the social pattern of the fabric itself.
I heard another voice answering in agreement, yet with a troubled note evident in its tones. As if the speaker felt that agreement alone was not enough, that simply denouncing a thing that was as evil as this would not be enough.
Yes, this murderous effort is doomed to failure. The intelligent members of the guilty Rodite must realize that such murder of the normal life unit is the refusal of their own right to share in the fruits of the social project. They must realize that such men as the Titan youth they killed have a potential value as great as their own.
Another voice chimed in.
And why is it refused recognition? If they are intelligent, then why do they act so detrimentally? It must occur to them soon, or it will be too late.
Unless they are all mad,
said the first speaker.
The sane unit of such a project will see that the basic unit right is inherent to their own success, and realize that destroying those rights will wreck their own plans. The only thing it can be is the explanation a Titan growth technicon offered. That some Rodite have been detrimentally charged by disintegrant coil leaks.
I could not help breaking into the conversation.
That is right. The thing has been explained to me that way, as a detrimental hypnosis, in which the ego, or self-will, the self-recognition of the mind centers, confuses its self-originated impulses with the exterior-originated detrimental impulses to destroy. Such a condition is called Dero.
Pressed for a more complete explanation, Mr. Shaver has defined Dero for us. Long ago it happened that certain underground cities were abandoned, and into their cities stole many wild mortals to live. At first, they were normal people, though on a lower intelligence plane, and ignorant due to lack of proper education. It was inevitable that certain inhabitants of the culture forests lose themselves and escape proper development, and some of them are of faulty development. But due to their improper handling of the life force and ray apparatus in the abandoned cities, these apparatii became harmful in effect. They simply did not realize that the ray filters of the ray mechanisms must be changed, and much of the conductive metal renewed regularly. If such renewals are not made, the apparatus collects in itself, in its metal, a disintegrant particle which gradually turns its beneficial qualities into strangely harmful ones. These ignorant people learned to play with these things, but not to renew them. So gradually they were mentally impregnated with the persistently disintegrative particles. This habituates the creature's mind, its mental movements, to being overwhelmed by detrimental, evil force flows, which in time produce a creature whose every reaction in thought is dominated by a detrimental will. So it is that these wild people, living in the same rooms with degenerating force generators, in time become Dero, which is short for Detrimental Energy Robot. When this process has gone on long enough, a race of Dero is produced, whose every thought movement is concluded with the decision to kill. They will instantly kill or torture anyone whom they contact, unless they are extremely familiar with them and fear them. That is why they do not instantly kill each other, because being raised together, the part of their brain that functions has learned very early to recognize as friend or heartily to fear the members of their own group. They recognize no other living thing as friend. To a Dero, all new things are enemy. To define, a Dero is a man who responds mentally to disimpulse more readily than to his own impulses. When a Dero has used all defective apparatus full of disparticle accumulations, they become so degenerate that they are able to think only when a machine is operating and they are using it. Otherwise, they are idiots. When they reach this stage, they are known as Ray, a Lemurian word not to be confused with Ray as it is used in English. Translated, Ray means dangerous or detrimental energy animal. Ray is also used to mean a soldier, one of those who handles beam weapons. Note how the ancient meaning has come into our modern word. Editor. Or detrimental energy robotism. The thing is simple enough, but I cannot understand how it could happen here in Tean City, where perfection in romantics is so old. Such an occurrence is guarded against by many battle row, by great organic battery brains raised for just that purpose. How could it happen? The two titans looked at me and shook their heads. They knew as little as I how it could be.
Well, it couldn't, but it did,
Arl said with feminine logic, and taking me by the arm led the way to a Rolat. In a moment we were speeding away from the dangerous area. Beside me, Arl relaxed with a sigh, and I felt her trembling with reaction. I put an arm around her. Brave girl, I whispered. We were soon nearing Arl's apartment. And looking down at her fresh young face, I felt a wave of worry pass through me. I wish we were under that newborn sun right now, on those freshborn planets of life with clean new coordinating mechanisms, under Rhodite we ourselves selected, and could therefore trust. I fear that the migration has been too long delayed. The old sun's disintegrant pressure upon the unseen base of our life is now too great for anything else to happen than what happened tonight. Can we help to strive against this immense air, deep-seated in the control minds about us, as it must be? Or must we flee at once, before they make impossible our flight, thinking of it as a danger of tail-bearing? But Arl's lips were on mine as the Rolat slowed before her home, an effective quiet as to my dangerous words, and my mind no longer dwelt on the fear, nor imagined the embrace of a six-armed giant Sibyl female, or the crushing coils of a snake woman about me. For it was too busy recording the ecstatic sensations of the intense, vital charge the fawn-legged girl threw into her embrace. My mind gave up its worry in Arl's soft contact. The next day, I entered the classroom and found it empty. I went to the incubation laboratory and found several other early students standing there in silent consternation, the fear welling up almost to openness in their eyes. The Titan was not present, nor were any of his attendants. Some of the embryos were dead, others half-smothered, because no attendant had turned on the filtered enriched air tanks, which kept their nutrient fluid supply aerated. I started toward them, but a young son of a Titan stopped me. I turned them on, he said in low, evenly measured tones.
Where is the Titan? I asked. No one knows, was the answer I got from all. Other students came in now, among them Arl. She came to my side, but remained silent, troubled. We waited a short time. Then a student called Tutor sent her to inquire. He turned to us with a peculiar look in his eyes.
They say he is ill.
Ill? The exclaimed question burst from all of us. In Atlan, this was startling. Illness is almost unheard of, a rarity existent only on the space frontiers where new varieties of germs were sometimes troublesome. The news brought Arl close to me, her silky furred tail trembling as shudders shook her slim body.
Utan, I am afraid, she whispered.
Her fear transmitted itself to me, and the thought came into my mind that this room was not safe. The same thought obviously had come to the others, because our movement toward the exit was as though by mutual accord. There was obviously some awful connection between the Black Deaths and the Titan's strange non-appearance. Yesterday the Titan had said a guard ray was on while he spoke to us so gravely of the fear. Had that guard ray been no guard at all? Had those evil Rhodite penetrated the guard ray, heard his words, known the Titan as a menace to their plan? The class was dismissed. This time by fear. And somehow I knew that the thought in my mind was in the mind of all. We had the same knowledge the Titan had. We were in the same danger. We were marked for disappearance, illness, or the Black Death. We must flee, now or never. Proof of the thoughts of the others came almost instantly. As we trooped in assumed lightheartedness down the tunnel toward the roulette ways, one of the accompanying youths proposed a picnic in the forest to celebrate the unexpected holiday. He said it loudly in a gay voice. And the others chorused their delighted approval, a delight that Arl and I feigned, too. All fell in with the project, the unspoken desire to flee the city strong in our breasts, our anticipation of being together among the trees which subterranean dwellers seldom see, strong, too. I raced ahead with Arl, shouting gaily, "Let me lead you to the elevators!" There was meaning in my voice and intent in my mind. I was not forgetting my promise to my friend, the control man. We reached the shaft that led to Sub-Atlan, from which we would take another lift to Surface Mu. There, as we shot upward, I whispered the news to the control man. "The terror is loose in Tean City," I concluded. "Escape as soon as you can. If at all possible, beg off from another descent and be away. There is great danger for all whom they suspect are aware of them." He retained a straight face, but I could see the concern in his eyes and the determination to make good his escape also. As we lolled in apparent ease on the soft sod of the culture forest, the traditional empty glass made its appearance in the circle. No one spoke of it, but its significant reminder of death's clutch was a constant thing in my mind. Never had fear and death been a part of my thought before. But that empty goblet with its sweetly spiraling stem uppermost was no longer just tradition, but now had a meaning almost immense. What to do to avoid that damnable mechanical play of detrimental force from the mind of some unknown Rhodite, staring through the viewplates of his defective, detrimentally hypnotic mechanism, seeking to destroy the best first. Just as lightning strikes the highest point, so does detrimental force seek the most active and the healthiest fruit first. They are most attractive. The detrimental is only a film over an integrative ion, which is attracted first to the most integrant bodies near. This holds true in thought movements also. Thus a Dero strikes at the best first. Editor. If they thought we were escaping, they would seek us out and snatch us back. I sat and mused. Simple magnetics, yet such mighty minds as the Atlans fall before it. We must be clever. I went on thinking of it, but again recurred the regret of last night. If only the migration had taken place a few years ago. But perhaps it had been so planned and delayed. Delayed by the Black Death, which had thus far struck so secretly and silently. The plan of the Rhodite must be near completion, or their secrecy would have been maintained. And then as I sat there, an idea presented itself. I knew a way to escape. And I spoke quickly before my thoughts were clear enough for any unseen listener to read. Let us all charter a spaceship and take a look at Mother Mew from above. There is no greater thrill than that to cap the day. As one, we leapt to our feet. I knew then that our thoughts had been very similar. I had only been the first to express the next step in spoken words. We will have to take a shuttle ship first, said a young Titan quickly. Come, I know the way.
There's a world going on.
If you enjoyed this video, please hit the like button and the subscribe button and the bell, and maybe leave a comment, maybe share it. Also, over on the other channel, I will say this though, we have a new video where we are ranking Pixar movies based on how well they fit Umberto Eco's definition of fascism. So that should be a fun watch. A lot to talk about there. There's a link to that in the caption of this video, so please check that out. In the meantime, thank you for watching. Thank you to everyone who supports me on Patreon, of course, particularly Zachary Snowden Smith, Break System BSE, Xana Zira, and Michael Fattori. And thank you for being you.